What's going on? How you doing, brother? Nice to see you, bro. You got a little 5 o'clock shadow today, dude. You good?
Yeah, I'm good.
All right, just checking, bro. I don't know. You're normally like super baby faced. Ricky's in the background. He just got cut up, looking shaped up, looking tip top. So what I wanted to talk to everybody about today is something that I've been kind of thinking about. I know Jose, me and you masterminded on it this Wednesday. Are these assassins of success, right? And this is coming from a book that I read and I'm currently reading by Dan Martell. Really good book called Buy Back Your Time. And, you know, after reading it, it's pretty interesting, Jose. I don't know if you've had an experience where you read something and like immediately you know that it's accurate because you've had direct experience with it.
Yeah, you know what I mean? For sure.
And immediately when I read this, I was like, oh, it's 100% accurate. You know, because I've had the good fortune of coaching agents for over a decade and going through that process myself of building a business, I knew that what he was saying was true. So we'll go over these. And I think it would be kind of interesting for me and you to reflect on kind of our journey and even currently today, which one of these or combination of these assassins pops up. Because I know it'll be beneficial for not only me and you, but for everybody else. So there's five different kind of assassins that can slow down progress, let's say, right? Because success is the progressive realization of a worthwhile goal and objective. Worthwhile is important. You know, trying to become the best drug dealer is not a worthwhile goal and objective. But the progressive realization, so progressive meaning like over time, and it takes time, and realization, you know, materialization of a worthwhile goal and objective. And these assassins, in my opinion, they slow down progress, okay, towards that worthwhile goal and objective. The first is the staller. So the staller can be described, if we're personifying the staller, as, you know, when there's a decision to be made and you procrastinate making the decision. There's an invoice to be paid for an event that you want to attend or something that you want to do. You've received the invoice. It's been in your mailbox for a month and you still haven't paid it. Or there's a decision that you're making about perhaps, you know, changing models or changing a company. And you're just stalling on making that decision, right? And I know for me personally, I don't know about you, Jose, and I've known you for a while. I don't think the staller is like your sort of thing. Actually, it might be just with people. But for me, that was something that was slowed down my progress, was perhaps stalling, like knowing that a decision made sense, but like taking too long perhaps to make it, right? So for you, did the staller ever kind of show up for you? And in what way?
I think it's just in different areas, and I got a list now. I have braces.
Oh, right, look at Jose. You got braces, bro? What'd you get, Invisalign?
No, I got the ones that go behind the teeth, but I'm having a little bit of trouble adjusting to saying certain things. So it's going to sound a little bit funny, but we'll work with it.
It's all good. How long do you have to have them on for?
1 year or less.
Okay. Did you stall on getting them?
No, I actually did not. I made the decision, it was kind of like, all right, I'm thinking now I maybe should have stalled on getting them because of the way that I sound. So I think the opposite of it. But it was kind of like one of those decisions that I was like, okay, I want to fix the bottom teeth and I needed to get it done. So I don't think there's ever a perfect timing to get it done. But I'll tell you where I have stalled. I've stalled in keeping people at my company that it hasn't worked out for a period of time. And I've known that it's not working out. And because I don't want to go out and find somebody else, I've stalled keeping them at my company for too long. Or sometimes because I felt bad for that individual, like meaning like, oh man, like this individual has a family or this individual has this or like, yeah. So I would say I've stalled. There's certain areas where I have stalled and there's certain areas where I don't stall, but I could see even when I was considering moving to EXP, Lars took me through the third party process and kept scheduling calls with me until he scheduled like two or three of them. He's like, so what should we do? And he kind of gave me that little extra push that I needed, but had I not been put through that process, I could have seen myself stalling a little bit longer on making the decision, basically. And I think when people stall, there's usually some sort of fear in the background. Like some sort of fear is usually in the background, and it could be different things for different people.
Yeah. And for me, the fear was just letting go of like money, you know? Like that's usually when stalling happens, right? It's like, oh man, or the perceived like, oh, like, you know, this might result in like a reduction of revenue or something like that. So kind of stalling on making a decision. And I see this regularly. I mean, we see this with people that we have calls with where, you know, fear trumps facts, bro. So we'll give people the facts and it makes all the sense in the world, but they'll stall. Well, I got to wait for this. I got to wait for fucking this, or I got to see what happens. I got to talk to this person. Like all of that is just a mechanism of stalling. Right.
I think what's equally important is what message are you telling yourself when you notice that you're stalling? So I'll give you an example. Like when I was stalling on moving to EXP, I went to my previous broker, and my previous broker was telling me that my business was going to drop because Remax had the number one market share in the area, and that the reason people did business with me was because I was with Remax. And my business grew at Remax, but then I started challenging that thought. I'm like, is this a real thought? And I was like, okay, Meet Kevin's not with Remax. He makes a lot more money than I do. Ryan Pineda's not with Remax. He makes a lot more money than I do. And I started naming different people that weren't at Remax, yet they had successful real estate companies or even just businesses in general. And what came to the surface was that it was a limiting belief. It was a story that I was telling myself. And I'll tell you like another thing that's happening right now that I got braces, like the first thought that came into my head, I'm like, fuck, are people still going to want to do business with me? Am I going to be able to explain things to people the same way that I've been explaining things to people? Like most of my selling is over the phone, and some of it is in person, and your voice over the phone is extremely important. And you know, the message I gave myself this morning, within 24 hours of me getting braces and me going through that, I'm like, fuck this. I'm like, I'm actually going to be better than I was because I'm just going to adapt to whatever it is, you know? But initially I was like, maybe getting braces wasn't the right decision. Maybe I should have waited a little bit long. And this morning I started changing the messaging that I was giving myself about the decision that I had made, basically.
I love that. And what it makes me think about is my son, he had to bring home a baby. It's like this very $1,500, like, you know, not real human baby, but like a kind of robot baby. And the baby cries and you have to like change its diaper and you have to feed it, right? And it wakes up in the middle of the night. So in middle school, I think it's a good way for them to, you know, experience what actually having a baby is like. It's a form of contraceptive in a way. And it was interesting because I heard him doing that with himself in the car. So I took him to his soccer practice. You have to bring the baby with you. Baby starts crying. He's like, Dad, can you help out? You know, you got to do this stuff. And like, yeah. And then he's in the car. You know what I hear him saying to himself? It's only 2 days. It's only 2 days. I'm only gonna have to do this for 2 days. Like he was prepping himself mentally, just like you were prepping yourself mentally. Like, you know, this is what, you know, I'll just handle this. But to your point, I think the staller shows up. And if you see yourself stalling, a really good question to ask yourself is like, what am I afraid of? Like what's underneath it? Is it a fear of letting go of money? Is it a fear that if I do this, to your point, people are going to think I sound silly and they won't want to do business with me? Is it a fear of how I'm being perceived? Is it a fear? And I think, you know, people would see you, Jose. I mean, you're the dominant king of, you know, Oxnard, let's say. And they'd be like, man, Jose doesn't have those thoughts. It's like, sure he does, man. Like it's normal. It's natural. It's just that he countered it very quickly and was like, nah, dude, that's not going to be like true.
It was probably within, if you count waking hours, it was probably within 10 hours that I started changing the messaging that I was giving myself. The other thing I would say as it relates to stalling is just anytime you're going through something like this, is just noticing it. That's the first step. You can't change something that you don't notice. So I noticed it and I was like, okay, I got to change the messaging. But here's what I would say to people. And you said this to me a long time. He's like, how can you expect clients that you're meeting with at a listing presentations to make decisions on the spot to sign a $20, $30, $40, $50,000 contract to work with you when you're stalling to make a $10 decision as to which something should I buy next. So the reason Aaron is saying that these stallers kill, they do, because you can't ask somebody, or you're not going to be good at asking people to make decisions on the spot if you're not good at making fast decisions yourself either. So that's what he means by that these assassins kill
progress,
the goals. Yeah, progress.
Yeah, and they kill progress. 100%. That's exactly right. So yeah, it's comical to imagine that, like, you know, you get upset with someone when they're you know, want to think about a really big decision with so much money on the line, where, you know, we will stall on, we'll put something in a cart in Amazon and won't buy it for like 5 days. You know what I'm saying? Like, it's like, come on, dude, that those two things don't make sense.
Shop around, like you're like buying a $500 something, you'll spend an hour, 2 hours shopping around to see different things. So when people are going to sign a $20, $40, $50,000 commission, like, it's a big decision for them, you know?
Yeah. Do you remember when we did that role play, and I forgot his name, but he would like always ask, and he doesn't show up anymore. But, we were talking about the commission, and then I started to close Jay. And I was like, hey, so do you think if you talk to me on a regular basis that would improve your business? He's like, oh yeah. I'm like, how many more extra deals do you think you do? He's like, I don't know, like probably like 10. And I'm like, great. And what's your average commission? He's like, $15,000. I'm like, wow. So in other words, you can make an extra $150,000 if you talk to me on a regular basis. He was like, yep. I'm like, great. I'm going to send you the coaching agreement at $2,500 a month or whatever it was. And then he got like, oh, wow. I'm like, wait, time out, bro. You were just asking somebody for like 30 grand and you get upset when it's time for them to like make a decision. But here you are stalling and slowing it down, right? It's the same thing. My intention in doing that for him was for him to see like, yo, you're no different. You're doing the exact same thing, right? So it's not that we make decisions hastily. I don't want people to hear that. But it's more like when you've done the research and the homework and it makes sense, and I'm still not doing it, you're stalling.
Well, and then here's the other thing. Like, so my question to people is, what are you stalling on? Like, what is it that you're stalling on? And just know that this stalling mechanism is probably, I'd probably say, one of the most common ones that most people stall on making decisions.
Yep.
And if you're able to make decisions faster and move forward in lieu of fear, you're able to basically accomplish, like, I've had fear at different stages of my career. Like when I bought my first apartment complex, like a lot of people would have bailed out on that. They would have been like, oh no, there's too many uncertainties, there's too many unknowns. Sometimes the question I ask myself when I notice I'm stalling or I'm kind of hesitating, which is kind of similar, is like, what's worst case scenario?
Yeah, you do that regularly when we've been around each other. You're like, what's worst case scenario?
I think I jump faster at worst case scenario than most people. And I always jump faster at second or third step. Like, meaning like, okay, if this happens in this, but I'm already thinking about two and three, if that happens. And then if I'm okay with worst case scenario, or if I'm okay with second or third layer consequences, then I'm good with it and I'll move forward with it in lieu of, despite me not knowing everything as well too. But I think that can help people as well.
Yeah, I agree 100%. So good. So that's the staller. So go ahead and drop in the comments if the staller has showed up in your life before. And if so, around what? The next one that we can talk about, the next assassin that slows down progress, is actually the opposite of the staller. It's the speed demon. And what the speed demon does is they make decisions like very, very fast and then never take the time to reflect on when it didn't work out. And then as such, they just continue to keep repeating the same mistake. So an example would be like, oh, they hire out of pain, not out of gain. So I need somebody right now. And they look around, they're like, oh, well, my cousin needs a job right now. And they just like pull them in. And then it doesn't work out. But then they never take the time to reflect why it didn't work out. So then they're doomed to repeat that over and over and over and over again. You know, if you've ever noticed, Jose, I'm sure you have because you've been in business a long time. Like, I've noticed like you know, some people like have a really hard time with not only hiring, but retaining staff. And I believe that this is one of the reasons why, right? It's because they make decisions like super quick, and they think that's the way, and they just keep plowing through by making more decisions on top of it, but they never actually take the time to reflect when it doesn't work out. So they're doomed to repeat that poor decision over and over and over again.
Yeah. I think a lot of that has to do with like thinking long-term as well too, as opposed to short-term. And mm-hmm. I think the reflection part is the key. And I think it's funny because when something doesn't work out, like we lost a deal right now that it was the owner wanted a cash offer, and I went for a listing instead of a cash offer. And guess what? Who he sold to?
A cash offer.
A cash offer, 100%. So like the very first thing that me and the gentleman I was working this deal with, we were like, okay, like what could we have done differently? Like what adjustments could we have made? And then at first it was like, no, everything we did was good, but that wasn't the case. I'm like, no, I probably should have paid attention to this. No, he let me know of this versus that. No, this and that. So we're like making adjustments right away and being like, because what happens is that sometimes you get comfortable. Like I had been selling properties to a hedge fund, and the hedge fund wasn't interested in buying it, but I had a wholesaler that has helped me with dispositions in the past. And I probably could have just tied it up and basically worked with him on this deal, and it would have been like easier. So it just taking the time to reflect, I think, is a key. But making sure that when you reflect, you're coming to the right conclusion, meaning sometimes people will reflect and it'll be like the wrong conclusion, meaning like it's outside of me. Like, let's say that for that person that is hiring people and it doesn't work out, they're like, oh, well, the job market sucks, or there's no good employees right now, or everybody out there, or I'm the only one that's going to be able to deliver on this. So sometimes people in that reflection, they blame things outside of them versus being like, what could I have done differently, and taking ownership of that. And I think that's also a key, making sure that you take ownership of whatever doesn't go right or the way that you want it to go right.
Yeah, I agree. What I wrote down as you were saying that is like extreme ownership and just like accountability. So instead of placing blame externally, you know, like, well, they weren't the right fit, or like the job market sucks, or it's so hard to find good talent, or, you know, that sort of thing. It's like, all right, well, how did I contribute to this? Do I have an SOP around hiring? Did I use a personality profile? Like, mm-hmm. you know, did I hire out of pain instead of gain? Is there a training process that's in place that people can follow, and for 3 weeks, they don't actually do anything until they go through that training process? Like, what is the system, right? And yeah, and then if you do that, so pain plus reflection equals progress. Pain plus reflection equals progress. The issue is when people experience pain, they usually don't take the time to reflect. Instead, what they do is what you were saying, which is blame. And that's problematic, right? It's not mature. It's not a way to like grow. If you just take the position of extreme ownership, which is a wonderful book by Jocko Willink and Leif mm-hmm. Babin, you know, it prevents you from trying to place blame elsewhere, and causes you to actually learn and grow as time progresses. So making decisions super quickly and not reflecting is also something that stifles progress. Now, me personally, that's not something that like one of the assassins that, you know, show up for me. And I'm imagining it's not really one that shows up for you that much, is it?
No, I think that I have pretty good judgment, because I typically do reflect on a lot of things. And here's the thing that I do as well too. Not only do I reflect on the things that happen to me, I reflect on the things that happen to other people around me. And that usually helps me out tremendously. Like, it was funny because my dad would tell me stories growing up. And one of the stories would tell me, hey, you see that gentleman over there? And I'd be like, yeah. He's like, well, that guy used to make a lot more money than I did. But what he did is he partied his money away, and I basically invested in real estate instead. So I reflected on that, and I'm like, okay, what's the message there that I received from it? I'm like, well, you can make a lot of money, but if you're pissing it away, there's a time and place where you may not be able to make the same amount of money. And if you piss all that money away and you weren't smart with your money, you may wish that you were in that position again where you were making that $1 million a year and you may not be in that position in the future. So because you piss it away, you have a lot of regret. So I'll reflect on things that happen to my friends. I'll reflect on things that happen, like things that I hear from clients. And that helps me be like, okay, like, I don't want to do that. I want to do this, or I want to do this instead, you know?
Yeah. And the thing that you also do too, because I've been a part of that, is you also triangulate with people who have demonstrated track records of good judgment over an extended period of time. So not only do you come to your own conclusions, but then you will reach out to people that have demonstrated track records of good judgment, which we would label those people believable. And then you triangulate with them. You're like, yo, this is what I'm thinking. Like, what do you think?
I'll ask them right? what they think. Yeah.
Yeah. And me and you do that with each other regularly, where like, you'll be like, yo, what do you, and I'll do that with you. I'll be like, yo, what do you think? And then because we both have demonstrated track records of good judgment over an extended period of time. So, you know, if you don't have people in your ecosystem to that effect, like seek them out. You know, you could always reach out to me or Jose and ask a question. I'm not saying like we're perfect at judgment, but we definitely have demonstrated track records of good judgment over time.
Yeah. And then I think too, like, I've reached out to people that have already done what I want to do. Like, I'll give you another example. Before I approached you as a mentor, I verified your production. Meaning I went online and I looked up on Zillow and I was like, how much homes has Aaron sold in the last 12 months? And at that time, you were selling anywhere from 150 to 200. So I was like, verified. I think a mistake that people make is when they're triangulating ideas, they're triangulating ideas with people that haven't done what they want to do. Like, they're getting advice on buying an investment property from somebody who doesn't own any investment properties. They're getting advice from buying their first home from, like, I know somebody out there that's like, no, don't buy right now. The market's going to crash. And they're telling everybody that, yet they don't own any real estate, you know? And it's like, so I think that's important as well too, when coming up with this.
Yeah, no, agreed. Like 1,000%. Is, you know, we live in a time where you don't have to be competent to be famous. And a lot of people are like, you know, just don't have the demonstrated track record. They want to be that influencer. They want to be the person who gets attention, but they want it for the wrong reason. You know, there's a saying that says like, if somebody like doesn't want the leadership position, they're probably suited for leadership, right? I think a lot of people want like the title, they want the perks, they want the accolades, but they don't want to have to do what leaders actually do, right?
I think, here's the last thought for me on that. I think if you are suffering from being the speed demon, just getting really good at asking questions about anything that you're hastily making decisions on. Like, so I probably should have asked more questions about the braces, just thinking about it. I probably should have been like, okay, like, like the interior ones, what do they do? Which one has the least amount of lisp on it, you know? And I just didn't. I was like, those look nicer. I want those. But I think whenever you're a speed demon, sometimes it's a lack of asking sufficient questions. Like, okay, what about this? What about that? And making an informed decision. I think that's the best thing people can do.
Yeah. And I think also a counter to the speed demon is to ask yourself a question like, what is the decision that's best in the short term? And what would be the decision that's best for the long term? Because really, the longer you can think in longer time horizons, the better judgment you will have, right? Because really what judgment is about what's best for the long term.
Yeah.
Right. So the longer you can kind of think in terms of time frames, the better decisions and choices that you'll make. And it's interesting because, you know, choices and decisions are really the only things that we truly own. And they really have an enormous impact on, you know, the quality of the outcomes that we produce. And yet nowhere in our formal education are we taught to be better decision makers. Nowhere. Mm-hmm. You can get a master's degree, like PhD, like nobody teaches you how to become a better decision maker, or nobody teaches you the quirks in thinking, you know, like resulting, which our brain does. Just because it happened before means it's going to happen again. It's like, no, it doesn't. Right. Or the endowment effect, because it's mine. I think it's better. That is a flaw in thinking. Right. Or the fact that our brains are wired for short-term immediate stuff, right? Because 50,000 years ago, we're running around from bears, lions, and tigers. So like, we're just optimized for like right here. So it's difficult to think out in longer time horizons. So yeah, I think the more that you can, there's a really good book that helped me in that area. It's called Thinking in Bets by Annie Duke. She's a professional poker player, but she talks about the psychological component of, you know, making decisions, because that's what poker players do all the time, and kind of thinking in probabilities instead of exacts, realizing that there's two things could be true at the same time. It's just like, which one's more true and which one's more true for the long term. And we, how many conversations have me and you had like that? Like, we'll be like, yeah, bro, like, yeah, this is, because again, you know, we have long track records of good judgment. We'll say, you'll be like, yo, here's my assessment of reality. And I'll be like, well, here's my assessment of reality. And then we'll triangulate, be like, okay, optimized out for the long term, which one is more true? And we don't care who's right. It's not like I'm like, oh, well, I'm right and you're wrong. It's more like, no, I just want to get to optimized long term, which one is more true, because that's the one that we're going to go with.
Yeah, even yesterday, I was talking to a loan officer about a client that they submitted an offer on a listing. And I'm like, hey, what are the odds of you being able to close this loan? And he goes, oh, they're really good. I'm like, no. Like, if you had to put it in terms of a percentage, what would you say that percentage would be? Would you say like 50%? Would you say 80%? Would you say 90%? And he goes, I think it would be like 85%. And I'm like, what would keep it from being 100%? And he goes, well, if the client doesn't like something on the request for repairs, then that's at 15%. I wouldn't be able to get it done. I'm like, no. I wasn't referring to that. I was referring in terms of your job only. What are the odds of you being able to close this loan? He goes, 100%. I'm like, that's what I wanted to hear. Thank you.
So, yep. Just trying to get down to the percentage, and then you can make a decision from a probability perspective, right? And I think like thinking in probabilities, or recognizing that two things can be true at the same time, really frees up thinking, because I think most people enter into conversations as though there's one thing that's absolutely true and one thing that's absolutely not. And that's not reality. Reality is it's a spectrum, and two things can be true at the same time, but it frees me up to like no longer be attached to being right, but instead focus all of my kind of thinking or analytical power in figuring out what's more true. Cause that's really what I'm interested in. Right. So the next assassin that can get in the way of progress is the supervisor. And what that is like, you know, we hire someone to help us. We recognize we can't just trade time for money, and we need to trade money for time. And then what I see people do is they end up hovering over that individual that they've hired due to a lack of trust or a lack of systems, because they don't have a system for them to follow, right? And then they end up taking it all back from them, right? And that keeps them out of the income producing activities, prospect, lead, follow up, go on appointments, negotiate deals, and they end up stalling out in terms of production.
Yeah. So I think that it's almost like the same thing as a micromanager, where you're basically micromanaging everything. And this is kind of a thought that I'm getting better at, is just, if somebody can do what you do at 80% capacity of what you do it to, they're better off doing it, because now at that time you have the leverage of people as well too, versus you. Meaning like, if you have two people doing it at 80%, that's better than you doing it at 100% basically.
Yeah, no, I would agree with that. Like, and what I'm aware of is, you know, delegation is a skill, and even if you don't trust the people, you need to have a system that you trust. Mm-hmm. So in other words, like, you know, McDonald's doesn't have, I think we can all agree they don't make the best burger, right?
What's interesting though, is, though.
Fair enough. I guess if you like that, so you got to get out more, bro. So the system though is so precise that they can hire people with very little education and pay them very little money, and it'll produce the same outcome every single time anywhere on the planet. And it's super precise. It's like, you know, cook the burger at this temperature in this oil for this specific amount of time, down to like the seconds. Then once it comes out, like, you know, warm the buns at this temperature for this amount of seconds, and then put this amount of pickles, you know what I mean? Like these pickles, and then put this amount of onions and this amount of ketchup. And right, it's systematized. And what I find is, in my opinion, I'm curious to see what you think, but the reason why people end up supervising and hovering is because they don't have a system that they trust. They haven't taken the time to download from their brain. You know, I was doing a talk last night and I was like, hey guys, I want you to realize something. Memory is not a system. It's not, right? So they don't have a system that they can trust somebody to follow. And now with technology, I mean, it's pretty easy, right? Like you just download from your brain, like here are the steps. You can shoot Loom videos or screen record videos or Zoom videos. It has a screen recording thing showing people how to do stuff. Now I have a system that I can hand to somebody and trust that they're going to follow it because it's all right there, right? You do that for listing coordination. You could do it for transaction coordination.
I agree. And it's funny because I was having a conversation with somebody one time. He's like, man, I've been having a lot of turnover with my assistants. And I'm like, they just can't seem to get it. And I'm like, okay, do you have a system that they follow? And they're like, what are you talking about? I'm like, yeah, do you have at least a checklist of all the things that they have to do? And he's like, no. I'm like, that's a problem. And he was trying to blame it on the assistants, but the real problem was him not taking the time and taking a step back to create a system and a process and a procedure that would allow him to basically delegate. Like even in our system right now, we have our checklist. Like it says, like import the pictures to Dropbox. And then we have a Google document that shows you how to import the pictures into Dropbox. So it's like literally like do this and then it gives you how to do it basically. And that's for almost every item in the checklist on the listing side, not on the buyer side yet, but that's taking the time to create a system right there.
Exactly. And now again, with the technology, like it makes it very easy to do that. And then I think the second reason why people have a hard time with this and, you know, the supervisor wreaks havoc for them is, you know, we grew up hearing things like, if you want to get something done right, you need to do it yourself. Mm-hmm. And then I think that's problematic because, you know, I would ask people questions. I'm like, well, how many people do you know that are very successful in business and have no employees? Zero. You know what I'm saying? So, and the people who gave you that advice were employees. And what it leads to is a lack of trust because it's like underneath, like you can't trust people. Right. And I think that that's like an issue. I had a coaching client where, you know, he was saying like, yeah, I'm getting back into the admin stuff. I'm like, why? And he's like, well, I don't know. I'm like, I know why. He's like, why? I'm like, because you don't trust people. And he fought me for like 40 minutes on a call. But then at the end of the call with the last 5 minutes, he's like, yeah, I think that's there's probably some truth to that. Right. Because I think that's what's underneath it.
Well, I think too, for me, whenever you're delegating things is being able to give people feedback and knowing that they're not going to get it right in sometimes the first time. But when like somebody doesn't get it right, letting them know what could have been done differently. And I think that that communication part is also clear communication as well too. Like one of the very first things when I learned about delegating was if I'm delegating something, somebody give somebody clear expectations. Like, hey, now I do this all the time. Hey, I need this market analysis. Can it be done by tomorrow at 10 a.m. instead of, hey, can somebody do this market analysis? Then it's 10 a.m. and the market analysis is not done. And I'm like, man, like, why isn't the market analysis not done? It's like, I didn't communicate properly of when I needed it by. And I'll even say, hey, no rush on this one. This one, I don't have an appointment until next week. If we take 7 days, we're good on it, you know? Mm-hmm. So I think giving people clear communication, having a system, and giving people feedback as well, too, as to how to do different things the way that you want the things done, basically.
That's exactly right. Right. So just noticing that, if you notice that you're hovering, if you notice that you're going into supervisor mode or that a supervisor's assassin is on the scene, like ask yourself a question. Do I have a system? Do I have an SOP, a standard operating procedure? Are there videos like showing people exactly how to do stuff? Do I have a system or a process for hiring? Am I using a personality profile, like the predictive index, you know, to place people? Is there a training process for like 3 weeks before they touch anything? You know what I'm saying? Like really kind of think that through. And that goes back to what we were talking about before, about taking like extreme ownership and accountability over it.
And I think just being okay with things not working out the way that you want them to work out sometimes, knowing that if you do this enough, it'll help you out. Like, there's been mistakes that have been made by our admin. It was funny, Mariela, when Mariela first started helping me in the business, a client called her. She goes, I want to cancel the listing with Jose. She goes, okay, sends her over the cancellation form. And I get back from an appointment and I'm like, she's like, yeah, so-and-so called, told me that she wanted to cancel. So I sent it to her and she signed it. I'm like, what? You did what? I'm like, usually our process when somebody wants to cancel is we need to have a conversation with them and see why they want to cancel. And then from there, we can make a decision as to what the best course of action is. And I had to be okay with going through a little bit of those growing pains, knowing that that was going to help me in the long run, basically.
Yeah. And I think what you're saying is true as far as like being okay with stuff not being like 100% perfect. And I don't think it's a realistic expectation that, like, you know, once you put somebody in a position, like nothing's ever going to like slip through the cracks or like whatever. And instead look at those situations as opportunities, because like what I'm aware of is, you know, it's how you strengthen relationships is how you deal with something when it doesn't work out.
Yeah.
You know,
when everything's going perfect.
Yeah. Not when everything's going perfect. Cause you could see somebody's like, you know, real character and how they treat people and like that sort of thing. So, all right, good. That's the supervisor. This next one definitely plagued me for a while, is the saver. So the one that's like saving a nest egg, and as such, they don't invest in themselves professionally in terms of coaching and training or courses. They also don't invest back in their business, in PPL, like paper leads, or in like telemarketers, or in you know, just things like CRMs, just making investments back into their business so they can generate money. So what happens is it impedes progress. And it certainly did for me. Like I'm not upset with the outcome, because, you know, I was storing and saving 50% of my income from the beginning and investing it in things that pay me money. What I'm also aware though, is that I could have grown much faster if I would have put even 25% of that back into my business to help me to grow and expand.
I agree. I think for me, as it relates to the saver, I don't think I struggled with that in terms of investing from the beginning. Like, I remember it was like, I think my fourth year in the business, I bought my second rental property by that time. I only had like 40,000 bucks. I needed 80,000 by the time I opened up escrow. It was a short sale, so it took a little bit longer, but I basically went all in, and I've continued to do that during my career now, where I think, and I don't think I've never had like a huge amount of money in my bank account ever, because it's always gone back into real estate. Now, what happens over time is that rents go up over time, values go up over time. So it was good, but where I don't think I invested enough was back into the business. Like, I didn't invest back into like a lot of marketing. It was like very, very lean, a very lean business. But I don't have a problem in terms of like hoarding money. Like, it was funny because a few months ago was the most amount of money that I ever had in the bank. But I knew that pretty soon, with everything that we had planned with the ADUs and the house, that it was going to start to go away. Basically. Yeah.
And truthfully, like, being around you in a way like helped me with that, because like I would see that. Again, there's two things can be true at the same time. So what I was doing was true, and it allowed me to, you know, invest money in order to receive residual and like that sort of thing. But I watched the way that your kind of relationship is with money, and your relationship with money, good or bad, is that like sometimes it can be not so great, but like this relationship where it's just like, yeah, like it just freely flows, right? Where for me, for a long time, it was very like, what I'm aware of is like the changes that I've made over the last 3 years that have provided me with time freedom and location freedom was because energetically my relationship with that changed. And I recognized like, oh yeah, like it requires me to, you know, when I made the transition to EXP, like it cost me a bunch of money. I lost a bunch of money on, you know, selling back ownership. I had to cap twice in a calendar year in order to make the change. And, you know, that's at the same time was good judgment.
Great decision.
Great decision. and what it's produced and kind of the movement and, you know, EXP coast to coast, like elite builders and stuff. So, or making decisions with, you know, hiring Ryan to teach me media, and that was a great decision. And even I talked to you about it. I remember I was going to I was thinking about getting a space and we were triangulating ideas. And you were like, yeah, bro, like there may be a time where that makes sense. But like right now, I think if you put more money into media, that would be a better use of capital. And you were right. So I did that. I thought about it. I'm like, yeah, I think that's accurate. And I went to 5 videos per week on YouTube. And that's been huge, right? It's led to, you know, lots of attention, lots of value being added to other people. So, yeah, but I understand where this comes from, Jose, because 65% of people grow up in families that live paycheck to paycheck in the United States. Mm-hmm. So because of that, we hear things like money doesn't grow on trees. I don't care how big the room is, dude. I could be in a room of 1,000 people. If I say that, they all yell it back to me. And I'm like, yeah, eat all the food on your plate. And a penny saved is a penny earned. And if you want to do something right, you got to do it yourself. And all of that programming, I think, leads to this mental map around money, that the goal and objective is to hoard it instead of to reinvest it back into attention, back into your business, back into things that generate cash.
Not only that, but also recognizing that you don't always need money to make money. Like, meaning, like, a lot of people think that in order for them to flip a property, that they have to have saved all this money in order to do it. No, you just need to find somebody with money that doesn't have access to that property. It was funny. One of our EXP partners found a flip. He never flipped the property before. Went to one of his family members, said, hey, I've got this opportunity. Would you like to do it? I don't have any money. The person was the money person, and he was the person who had the deal. They split the profit 50-50 on it. You know,
there you go. Yeah. Love that.
And it required no capital from his side.
Mm-hmm.
Now, is saving important? Yes. But if you're saving and not investing, it's actually losing money, because you're not making money on that money, basically. It's just like sitting there. And with inflation being the way that it is, you're basically like, your dollar has less value unless it's invested in something, you know?
Yeah, I agree, Mike, 100%. And recognizing that, like, the real currency is knowledge.
Yeah.
Not money. So the real currency, the thing that's going to radically change your life, is information. Like, both mine and your lives have changed dramatically because of a handful of relationships where somebody imparted a specialized knowledge that you can't learn in school to us. And that's what allows us to do what we do. That's what allows, you know, you see what I mean? So like, if that was true, if I knew that that was true, I'd be willing to trade money for information all the time. And what's also true is that attention is actually more valuable than currency. So if I really knew that that was true, I would be willing to trade money for attention all the time.
Well, right? I think it's, even you, huh?
Go ahead.
I would say you went over an example one time. They're like, let's say that you were a CEO of a company and you had like a board of chairmen there. And the board, as a CEO, your job is to allocate funds and where to allocate those funds. It's like, if you were the CEO of a company, like, and Angel asked me this, he's like, when he saw that I was buying a bunch of rental properties, like, hey, Jose, have you ever thought about this? You're investing $100,000 on a down payment for a rental property. It's going to make you $2,000 a month, which is $24,000 a year. And your money's kind of stuck there. He's like, what if you invested those $100,000 back into marketing for your business? Like, or what if you invested it back into your business? Could those $100,000 turn into $200,000 or turn into $250,000?
Mm-hmm.
You know? So even like, once you get out of the saving mentality, it's like, okay, what is the best place to invest this money? Is it in yourself? Is it in your business? Is it with rental properties? What is it? You know? So I think that one of the highest returns that you can make is an investment in yourself and an investment in your business. I think that that has the capability of growing a lot bigger than anything else.
Yeah. And what's interesting is when I say that out loud, it creates like a lot of like friction, which is like, you know, when I'm like, hey, until you're making $250,000 a year in income, you shouldn't worry about like investing money in like, you know, the market or investing in real estate. You should be pouring all of any excess capital you have back into yourself to get access to information, specialized knowledge, so you can get up to that 250 plus mark. Cause once you're there, you actually will have like a little bit to start, you know, actually investing sort of thing. But when I say that, people get upset, but I do believe that that's true.
Got it.
Yeah.
What's the next one?
All right. So the last one is the self-medicator. And the self-medicator, what they do is like to celebrate when things go well is like food or alcohol or substances. But then what they do is they turn to the same things when things aren't going well. So an example of this would be like, let's say you close like a big deal or whatever, you're super excited, you go out, you stay up late, you know, you put stuff into your body that's not great. And then what ends up happening is that takes you off track for Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, right? It's this like perpetual cycle that you're on all the time. And then when things aren't going well, you lean on the same things. And then by leaning on those things, it perpetuates, you know, the downside as well. So people can get caught. And, you know, I know like to deal with the stresses of doing business in high volume or selling real estate in high volume or, you know, investing or whatever, a lot of people look to those vices and you could be like a millionaire alcoholic, you know what I mean? Or like a millionaire with like a substance problem, or a millionaire who has this relationship with their food or weight that goes like up and down, up and down, up and down. And it has to do with the fact that we're using it as a mechanism to medicate, right? When things go well, that's how we celebrate. But then when things don't go well, that's how we try to cope with them not going well.
What's funny about that is I actually didn't realize that those two had an inverse relationship, meaning that like the same things that they use, or not, I don't know if it's inverse, the same thing that they use to medicate when things are going well, they use it when things aren't going well. Like, and there are people that I know that they celebrate with alcohol when things are going well. And when things aren't going well, they also pick up alcohol. But I didn't notice how those two actually go hand in hand. Part of it is because I don't feel that, like my relationship was when I would be stressed out, I would eat food because of stress, because that would give me like some sort of comfort. And you saw it, like there's periods where my weight has fluctuated a little bit higher. And I would probably say that I've used food as a coping mechanism for stress, basically, you know?
Yeah, I agree. And I appreciate your like authenticity. And I think that I think a lot of people do. Like, it's not, you know, my experience is the people that produce the most favorable outcomes are usually the most self-aware. Right. So self-awareness is really powerful. Right. So if that's a mechanism that you've been using until now, and now that, you know, I know a lot of agents are having a hard first quarter, and you know, if you find yourself gravitating towards the self-medicating thing, like, you know, just recognize that and pivot back into something else that, you know, you can use as a mechanism, because you have vacillated. And I think you know this, you vacillated between perhaps like food to help with the stress, but also exercise to help with the stress. You've done 75 hard, like a couple times in a row. You know, I remember, you know, from 2020, 2021, that was a soothing mechanism for the stress, but you were just doing it with physical exertion and activity. But you've also done food where, you know, you might gain 15, 20 pounds, like in a particular stressful time in your life.
I read a book, it was called The Stress of Life or The Joy of Stress, one of those books. And it was funny because it said that when you're feeling stress, to stress out your body in a different way. And that's where I picked up the exercise. Like the exercise, I was like, all right. And it was funny because when I would, like, I like almost like overworked out myself during that period twice a day, you know, I didn't have time to be stressed after that. I was fucking like
exhausted,
you know. Yeah. It wasn't stress, it was exhaustion at that point, you know.
Yeah, no, and I think that there's two different types of stress. There's like you stress, which the prefix you means like good, like euphoria, right? And then there's distress. They're two different things. So you stress might be like, you know, you're gonna give a talk, you know, and okay, that's like good stress, or you, because pressure is a privilege, right? So that's good stress, and it causes you to like, you know, move forward. Distress usually is me up in my head, like ruminating or worrying or like whatever, you know, unless there's some sort of physical, like, you know, trauma or something that's taking place. But like distress is different. So I think it's like very helpful to like recognize, and I know we've done a lot of work with like gremlin taming, like recognize, like getting a sliver of light between what is actually true and what I'm imagining is true. And noticing, like, am I catastrophizing? Like, am I making this into like this whole thing? Like, am I sitting in a movie theater in my mind and watching the most terrible outcome possible? And then my body, because my brain doesn't recognize if that's actually real or not. So it produces the same physical, emotional fight or flight response as it would if it was real, right? So like my body gets flooded with cortisol. My body gets like, you know, I start to breathe shallow and quick and like all this other stuff. And here I am like sitting in my room. I'm not being chased by a tiger. I'm not, you know, nobody's like holding me up at gunpoint sort of thing. So just going back to what we were saying before and what you brought up is just recognizing how I may be contributing to that, how I may be exacerbating it, how I could be making it worse in some way.
I agree 100%. So if somebody is finding themselves self-medicating because of the market, because of their production, because of different things, what would you say to them?
Yeah. So I think you can't change what you're not aware of. So the first is to become aware of it. I think the second is to, you know, create, like perhaps pull out a journal and notice like when the desire pops up and notice like what the feeling is that you're trying to medicate. Is it fear? Is it anxiousness? Is it despair? Is it tension? Like, what is it? And then, you know, begin to like ask yourself like, okay, is there another way that I could, you know, perhaps process it. I think the other thing that's true is when you do that journaling and you just sit with the feeling, you'll notice that it'll pass. So it's like, they're like clouds, you know, it's not like it's there forever. Like it dissipates, but the issue is just sitting with it long enough for it to dissipate. Right. And then I think the other thing you could do too is, which I learned from Rick, is like chair work, where like you sit in one chair and you can make yourself super uptight and anxious and like breathe shallow and quick and like kind of create the physical manifestations of what you're feeling like internally, even if it requires you to like pick your knees up and scrounge them up and like, ah, and say out loud, you know, what that monster of the mind is telling you, like, oh my God, I'm gonna end up broken alone by myself and blah, 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 and do that for like a minute and time it and then sit in another chair. And in that other chair, you're like peachy keen hunky dory, breathing calm and clear, taking in all the air that you like, exhaling fully and completely. Your spotlight of awareness rooted in the present moment called now, that it can go out into the world to create, to love, to produce, to enjoy, and do that for a minute and go back and forth. Because what you're doing is you're showing the observer, the one who has a body, but is not their body. The one who has the name Jose, but is not his name Jose. The one who has thoughts, but is not his thoughts. You're showing that one, the observer who's been watching this thing go down, the witness or the watcher, the one who learned how to walk and talk with no instruction. You're showing that one that you have a choice which experience you want to bring to yourself, right? Which chair you want to sit in. And then in doing so, you bring yourself to a place of choice, and then you can, you know, kind of take it from there sort of thing. So that would be my recommendation.
I love it.
That's what we do here. We do the good shit, not the bullshit. So from my brother from another mother, Jose, and from me to you, we hope this has been an enjoyable use of your non-refundable precious breaths. If you like this, tune in next Friday. Same elite time, same elite channel. Elite Builders Coast to Coast.
There, guys.